The title of this conference combines two cities that have seemingly little in common, Rome and Kyoto. And two worlds that are traditionally opposed, history and myth. In Thucydides' words, Nietzsche says, addressing the Athenians, "Men are the city, not the walls." The ancient Western city is in fact, par excellence, the city of monuments, that is, the city of memories, as the Latin word itself, monumentum, says. Examples embodied in an urban image that becomes itself an ideal mythical model. This is the sense of imago dei. Ancient Rome is thus essentially a city of images, of memories that have not only the power to evoke, warn, but also to multiply and relaunch in the future with their accumulation, their mythopoeic power, myths that produce other myths. They are actually the only existing capital cities of ancient empires whose origins coincide with those of the city itself and of the first urban life, which is to say the origin of the state and the history as such. Cities surviving not as archaeological realities, but living with unbroken continuity until today and maintaining even the essential part of their original appearance. And Kyoto, even more than Rome, by virtue of more a conception of time, the Eastern one, more circular than the Greek Roman tomb, a kind of eternal prison, to simplify. You can understand it by looking at the images of the city. The ancient reticular orthogonal plan of Kyoto is in fact still perfectly recognizable in the present upright roads board surrounding the imperial palace and in an urban design which has not undergone substantial changes. In fact, we consider that the parallel between Rome and Kyoto is not only the one between two cities, but between two opposing and universal models of cities. Rome may, in fact, be taken as the most complete model of the Western polis that has in the middle the forum, the agora, the square. In short, the place where the people come together to discuss and choose their magistrates. Whereas Kyoto still preserves in its imago the imprinting of the original Western Eastern city, that is, the original city as such. The first city appeared in history, the palatial city, rising for the first time in Mesopotamia and going from Greece to China to the pre-Columbian civilization. A large circular or square, in this case, area which contains within the priest-king's palace temple warehouse.
All that remains of Jargan, today's Yan, is an archaeological layer. Whereas Kyoto remained the capital for a millennium until 1868, and it is now still visible and extraordinarily faithful to its original layout. Therefore, Kyoto maintains and transmits directly to us the imago of the main historical city of China and also of its first and most enduring capital under several dynasties. Chang'an had in fact been preceded in the same area by Xianyang, seat of the first unification of China under the command of the first emperor Shi Huangti in 221 BC. The funeral ornament of this emperor, the Terracotta Army, famous worldwide, was found near the city in a mausoleum where it remained untouched for more than 2 millennia. And it is remarkable the fact that the mausoleum had neither public nor monumental role, as it happened in Rome, Greece, and throughout the Middle East. The image of the city, much more than in the West, it expresses in symbolic terms the complexity of a system of social and cosmic relations based on a balance of elements into an organic whole. The ancient Chinese thought has developed a vision of reality as a system of relationships based on analogy, opposition, the differences, and the global unity of microcosm and macrocosm, man and nature. The city is the country's image, China, and the world's image, of which China occupies the center and of the cosmos. The world is imagined square in shape and as a mirror of the universe, and to this form turns the country itself, called the Middle Kingdom, and conceived as the center of the earth, and the shape of the city too, a veritable microcosm specular to the heavenly macrocosm. The city of the heavenly emperor occupies, for this, the ideal location center of the country, and the emperor, in his turn, lies at the heart of the city, where ideally there was the vertical axis of conjunction between heaven and earth. He is the guarantor of the harmony between heaven and earth, on which the physical and political life of man is founded. In the words of Greek and Latin, we can say that he is the living omphalos of the city and the cosmos, the umbilicus orbis omnis et mundi, guarantor of harmony between heaven and earth. But even more significant is a coincidence which we realized as we were writing these pages. The 12 openings of the Ming Tang correspond exactly to the 12 points of the lozenge design that Michelangelo enclosed in the ellipse on the floor of his ideal city, and to the 12 points of the central star on which is placed the pedestal of the statue of Marcus Aurelius. They are absolutely clear cosmological emblems in which we recognize, in the classic monumental language of the West, the same concepts we find in the Ming Tang. It is as if Michelangelo had re-established for the last time Rome, and it is the confirmation that a city is always a mirror universe and can only be founded in relation to the celestial city, an entity that is immaterial before being material, as we said at the beginning.